Good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Local Government, Housing and Planning Committee in 2022. I would ask all members and witnesses to ensure their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. Willie Coffey and Mark Griffin are both joining us remotely for today's meeting. We are also joined today by the convener of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, Eleanor Whittam, who is joining us for both evidence sessions on the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill under Agenda Item 2. And I welcome Eleanor to the meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take Item 4 in private. Item 4 is consideration of the evidence we've taken on the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill. Are we all agreed? Agreed. Thank you. We'll now turn to Agenda Item 2, which is to take evidence on the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill at Stage 1. This committee is leading on scrutiny of Part 4 of the bill, which makes provision to strengthen the protections from evictions for private rented tenants. We will hear from two separate panels of witnesses today, with the first consisting of stakeholders and the second being with the Minister for Zero Carbon Buildings, Active Travel and Tenants' Rights. We're joined remotely for our first session by Alistair Houston, who's a solicitor and head of Housing and Court Department at the Legal Services Agency, Matt Downey, who is Chief Executive of Crisis, John Blackwood, who is the Chief Executive of Scottish Association of Landlords, and Andrew Watson, who is a researcher at the University of Glasgow. I will aim to bring all witnesses into the discussion, but members, if you wish to direct a question to a particular witness, please make this clear to assist our broadcasting team in operating cameras and microphones. If any of the witnesses wish to come in on a particular point, please let me know by typing R in the chat function and I'll bring you in at an appropriate point. And I intend to allow around 75 minutes for this session, and I'll now open up the session to questions from members, and I'd like to begin with a question which I'm going to initially direct to Matt Downey. Do you agree that the Tennessee proposals in the bill will contribute to the Scottish Government's objective of addressing the harms caused by the pandemic and tackling systemic inequalities made worse by the pandemic? Matt.
Good morning. Well, thank you for the invitation and thank you for the question. I fundamentally do agree, yes. I think that the important backdrop to this is not just the pandemic, but also the Scottish Government's Housing to 2040 aim, that the housing system will be tenure neutral in Scotland, with the purpose of everybody, regardless of where they live, experiencing the same affordability, security and other arrangements that allow for their housing to be successful. And it's also the case, whilst that ambition exists, that those in the greatest housing need have the fewest housing options. And we see that through our services every day. And we know it to be true, particularly in relation to homelessness. And my view is that the provisions laid out in Part 4 of the bill absolutely do help to achieve a much greater sense of equity and improve life chances, because it's our view that the private rented sector can be a safe, secure and appropriate tenure, and that putting it on a stable footing and an equal footing with the social rented sector can be achieved by the measures set out in the bill, but for others that I hope to get into a bit more today, and that actually we can move from the private rented sector being a cause of homelessness to a really good solution to it. So perhaps that will give you some idea of the sort of comments I'd like to get into later, but I do fundamentally agree with your proposition.
Thank you very much for that, Matt, and painting an optimistic view. I'd like to bring in John Blackwood for your perspective on that question.
Yes, and thank you, convener, for inviting me along this morning to give evidence. Certainly a concern we have going forward is about investor confidence in wanting to continue to provide valuable housing in Scotland. And that's something we certainly, as the Scottish Association of Landlords, would like to focus on. We're certainly hearing from landlords up and down the country that they are concerned about the future viability of their businesses. here in Scotland, and many are opting to sell up and exit the market even now. The big concern we have going forward is that very soon we could see the doors to private renting being firmly closed to perhaps those who rely on it most, and we need to find ways to overcome that.
Thank you very much. I'm going to move on to another question, and that is there a need for these changes to be made permanent now, as opposed to as part of a wider package of changes that may be introduced as part of a future housing bill? And I'll bring in Andrew Watson on that one first.
I think a general point I would make is that including this change within the wider COVID recovery strategy, it may well have been overlooked in some quarters. I've seen very little discussion on social media, LinkedIn, etc., whereas the New Deal for Tenants consultation has received significant coverage in social media commentary. It might therefore have been better to locate the proposed changes within a single PRS-focused consultation. Something we'll probably return to later as well is that there is a lot of change in the PRS, building on a period where there's already been a lot of change. And I think sometimes that perhaps in the impact assessments and associated, we're looking at specific impacts of specific pieces of legislation rather than looking at the impact on the whole. For example, it states in the financial memorandum that it's unlikely there will be any significant loss of landlords due to this legislation. That may or may not be the case, but when it's taken in the round with changes to energy performance, future rent controls, etc., it may well have quite a profound effect on supply. And I think, therefore, having this separate from the consultation into the Tenants' New Deal is potentially a little bit damaging.
Thank you for your response. And Alistair Houston, do you have any thoughts on the idea of making the changes permanent now as opposed to part of a wider package?
I think I'm quite keen to see them being made permanent just now, and I would echo the comments from Matt Downey about equity of tenure. I don't see any reason why the private residential sector should not be put on an equal footing with the social sector. I think it's important to note that for the purposes of the resolution of homelessness, the private residential tenancy is already a statutory option for local authorities to fulfil duties to a homeless person. And I think it's therefore important that tenants in that sector enjoy the same protections and ultimately a harmonisation across the sectors.
Thank you for that. Is there anyone else who wants to come in? Okay, I'm going to move on to bring in Megan Gallagher with a question.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Committee and Panel. Before I ask my question this morning, I would like to refer members to my declarations of interest, or sorry, my register of interest, as I'm still a serving councillor in North Lanarkshire. Building on the answer that Andrew Watson gave in relation to the need for a consultation, in particular a PRS consultation, can I maybe ask Andrew firstly how sufficient was the Scottish Government's consultation overall on the Bill's proposals?
I mean, it was set out as would be standard and normal with a consultation process. I think certainly from the landlords I've spoken to, they weren't immediately aware of it because it was very much branded as a COVID recovery bill. So therefore, it may not have reached the attention of some of those that it was perhaps designed to. And as I said, there's obviously a lot of other things going on in the PRS at the moment that's maybe distracted attention from that bill. I'm not sure what the level response has been compared to other similar types of consultations, but it didn't strike me as being a massive response to date. But you may have a different opinion on that.
Thank you, Andrew. Could I bring in Alistair Houston, please?
Thank you. The consultation, from a perspective of completing it was user friendly, easy to understand. However, I do agree with the comments of Andrew that it may have been missed by some stakeholders, given that it forms part of the wider bill. But I do expect that those stakeholders who are particularly active in the sector were aware of it, and certainly the organisations that we work closely with were involved in formulating responses.
Thank you. And could I bring in John Blackwood just finally, please, from the Association of Landlords? Thank you.
Yes, really, just to concur with everything that's been said, I think that obviously there has been a consultation period. We've been involved in that consultation, which is obvious as a result of our involvement today. And of course, wider landlords have been made aware of it as well, too, certainly through our membership ways of engaging with our members at a local level and a national level. But I do take the point that I think we need to look at the bigger picture of the private rented sector. What purpose does it serve, and how can we properly and proportionately regulate it for the future, and at the same time instilling confidence in landlord investors?
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Megan. I just want to remind the panel that if you do want to come in on a question, put an R in the chat function if we haven't directed a question to you, and that way we can bring you in. We're now going to move to questions from Willie Coffey, who's joining us on Blue Jeans.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to everybody. My first question is probably aimed at Matt, I think. Matt, could you tell us a wee bit more about the impact that the temporary removal of the mandatory eviction actually had? What were the advantages of that as you see it?
Okay, well, thanks very much for the question. Yeah, so the advantage from our perspective is that when it comes to individual circumstances, a sort of a system whereby the ways in which homelessness can be prevented and circumstances can be improved are not always raised. They're not always clear when it comes from a mandatory system. And therefore, discretion in every sense allows for a sensible conversation that prevents the kind of human misery and cost and degradation that homelessness brings, and that obviously that doesn't make eviction impossible, and eviction will still take place, and we would always say that that's appropriate, and we need to are supported in this sector, and there are lots of ways in which that can happen and could be improved. But what we've discovered, I think, in the last few, in the last couple of years, in fact, is that actually homelessness through the private rented sector has decreased significantly because of these measures. The applications for homelessness assistance in local authorities on the basis of eviction from the private rented sector have plummeted, and that's because of the range of measures that were in place. So, and this relates to the previous question in the sense that actually, what we now see is a lot of concern from local authorities about pent-up situations of rent arrears and other situations where actually this is the time to bring in these measures and to bring in full discretion so that each and every one of those cases can be dealt with on its merits rather than a kind of a one-size-fits-all decision from the tribunal.
Matt, you mentioned there was a significant drop in the levels of homelessness. Do you have any of the, I think your report, your submission mentioned some of the figures, but do you have them to hand there? Just so that the members can be aware of that, what was the actual drop in the homelessness numbers that we experienced?
Okay. So the numbers of households presenting as homeless due to a loss of rental tenancies fell by 57% in 2021 compared to the previous year. So that's 4,651 people down to 1,999. It's a really significant drop.
Uh-huh. Thank you. Do any of the other panel members want to respond to that issue about the benefits of the measure that was introduced, or can I move on to the next question, Convener?
I believe you can move on to the next question. John Blackwood. John Blackwood would like to come in. And Andrew Watson.
Thanks. Yeah, thank you very much, Convener. This is something we did report on in our consultation response. We did analyse all the eviction cases that went before the first tier tribunal in 2021. And certainly one of the issues that we had was really how many tenancies were actually protected as a result of all grounds being discretionary. I mean, it comes down to actually we found there was only 3 tenancies which were protected as a result of all the grounds being discretionary. So we see the impact of this measure being negligible effectively.
Okay, John. Andrew?
I think I would agree with what John said there, but reiterate that the primary reason for the massive drop was the extension of notice periods to 6 months. That had a significant effect in the number of tenancies proceeding or not to eviction. So that was incredibly successful, but it also had a number of unintended outcomes, and it meant that by the time that most cases were agreed at tribunal, that 13.8 months or so worth of rent was in arrears. So, you know, you need to balance the success of people not being evicted and the savings to local authorities in terms of emergency housing provision with the fact that we've basically transferred the costs of housing those individuals from the public to the private sector.
Thanks, Andrew. My second question, probably for John, I think, if that's okay. John, to what extent do you think the proposal to remove the mandatory eviction grounds provides us with a kind of right balance between the rights of tenants and the rights of landlords? Could you say a little bit about that, please?
Yeah, I think our main concern really relates back to the 2016 Act, and that was the introduction of the new private residential tenancy. And that was very much hailed as a new piece of legislation that would give tenants, importantly, greater security of tenure, which is what the government intended to do. But beyond that, it also was hailed as a bit of legislation that would support private landlords and give them greater security and safeguards, effectively, certainly when it came to the tenancy regime overall and the grounds for repossession. And certainly in the last few months, all we've seen in our sector is a slow erosion of all those safeguards that was promised to us by the government and the Scottish Parliament. And the net result of that is that we're seeing private landlords really feeling, do you know what, we don't want to be in this sector anymore, and they're now considering to sell up. And from our recent survey of members, 1 in 3 are considering doing just that. And the overall impact that that will have in the provision of housing in the private rented sector is going to be dramatic. And we need to, as stakeholders, and certainly as politicians, consider that and the impact that has on providing much needed housing for those that need it.
Thanks, John. And I see Alistair wanting to come in to speak. Alistair.
Thank you. I can appreciate John's comments about the lack of certainty when all the grounds have been made discretionary. That lack of certainty can cut both ways, that at present, and as is proposed in the bill, the discretion that would be available for the first tier tribunal in relation to the private sector differs somewhat from that available to the Sheriff Court and the social sector, in that it is really an absolute discretion in the first tier tribunal. And you can contrast that with that available to the Sheriff Court, where at least there is a list of statutorily prescribed factors that the court is to have particular regard to, which are absent from the legislation. So that, coupled with a lack of statutory guidance, means that the interpretation of what is reasonable in a particular case falls entirely with the particular tribunal on a day. And I do agree that that causes a lack of certainty for both parties, that they can be influenced by tribunal members' individual views. The differing and weighting of circumstances in different cases and so on. So whilst I believe that it is possible to have discretionary eviction grounds, but to have a more rigid framework behind them to enable parties to work through them and have a better understanding of what may or may not be reasonable when it comes to eviction.
Thank you, Alistair. I see Andrew want to come in, and maybe Matt finally, just on whether we've got the right balance.
I think it's important to note that this is a revisitation of the debate that was held during the introduction of the PRT, when it was concluded that the combination of mandatory and discretionary powers offered the correct balance at that time. The research that we recently carried out, Nick Bailey and myself, did recommend the temporary extension of discretionary grounds for rent arrears through to September 2022. On the basis that the extended notice periods were to be removed. But this was primarily to provide an extra layer of protection as the pandemic moved to a kind of endemic stage. I have to note that 43% of landlords that we surveyed were happy for this to be the case, although a third did disagree. We didn't ask them about making those changes permanent, but we did ask them about that on the pre-action grounds, and they were steadfastly against that. I'd note that our kind of recommendations took a cautious approach, and I think that it was based on the situation that we faced at the time. But I think it can be argued that despite the impacts of the pandemic, which have been, you know, many and varied, there are still grounds in which discretionary consideration is appropriate. And again, it comes back to this kind of supply imperative. So the thing that's always rolled out is, and I think John's already mentioned it, is certainty. But knowing that a landlord knowing that they can get a property back after a fixed period of arrears within a fixed period of time at the tribunal is absolutely key to the investment case for the PRS, not just for the quarter of a million kind of small landlords dotted around the country, 5% of the population, incidentally. But also for the build-to-rent sector. And I think when you start looking at grounds such as landlord intentions to sell the property, now, why would a landlord sell a property? There's any number of reasons, but as it's an investment in most cases, one of those might be to buy an annuity, to pay for later life care, and not having certainty around being able to get the property back when required could cause issues with that investment case again. And I think it's similar when we look at landlords' intention to live in the property. So, for example, I relocated for work once and I rented out my property for a couple of years on the basis that I knew I was going to get that back when my assignment down south had finished. I no longer had that certainty. Would I potentially make different decisions about what to do with that property? And I think this is the much broader, wider consideration that we need to have. Landlords are extremely heterogeneous. They have very different motivations. Many of them are investment-based, but again, for different reasons. And by treating it as a kind of one-size-fits-all, which is what the mandatory thing, I think, does, I think is a mistake, and that it's something that we should really be looking a bit more detail at.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Andrew. Any final comment on that from Matt? On the balance, whether we've got it right, Mark?
Yeah, so thank you. I think it's important to note that there are two sides to this, and that from the tenant perspective, it's really important that the rights and chances that people have within the private rented sector are looked after from their perspective too. I do think the timing is right, and the timing does relate to COVID recovery, which is why it's appropriate to be in this bill. I would say though that if there are there's a period of time once this is enacted that we can assess whether it is actually true that we're losing landlords from the market and why we're losing landlords from the market, then that allows for any further kind of changes to be made. But I think it's important to pursue with this and then see what changes actually occur. And particularly because it's not just around the discretionary grounds, it's about obviously the pre-action protocols and other things that relate to this. So we need to see it as a whole system and whether A, the evictions, particularly that local authorities are worried about coming out of COVID, do happen, and then B, whether landlords do exit the market, and if that's the case, then what needs to happen in addition in the future. But I think now is the time, and this is the right balance, as you suggest.
Thank you, Matt. I see, convener, is there time to bring John back in? I think
yes, that's fine. John, if you want to come back in.
Yeah, I'll be very quick. I think one thing to bear in mind is, of course, that landlords are investors. We have to see them as investors running businesses. And as already been pointed out, some of them will have a future plan to de-invest, to sell up. It's part of their pension plan. That's just, it's a natural process that they will go through at some point. Or they're just renting temporarily. It's their own home. They want to have security to move back into their own home, which is very different to social landlords. They either have a statutory duty or they're providing a social function there in housing. So the motivations and the factors behind the business operation of that housing sector is very different. And largely in the whole, we are dealing with individuals, people who own just one or two properties. So when they feel that their investment is, quite frankly, at risk, they're going to get nervous, as all investors do. And the reluctant investors, as it is anyway, hence why they've invested in bricks and mortar. And what we are hearing from our members is that they're incredibly concerned and that they are planning on selling now, not later. We've got an issue now with a housing shortage in Scotland today. That's not something we should wait until it happens next year or in a few years' time. We need to actually deal with that issue today.
Thanks, John. Thanks, everybody. Back to you, convener. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Willie. We're going to now move on to questions from Paul McClellan.
Yeah, thank you, convener. And morning panel, can I refer everyone to my register of interest? I'm still a serving councillor on East Lothian Council. My question really was just going to be talking about investor confidence, but I think that seems to have been picked up in the last question. I suppose for yourself, John, it comes back to the point that Matt probably made around about, you know, let's just see, you know, you suggested the point, let's just see where this goes for the next year or so. Let the market kind of settle down, obviously, in the back of COVID and so on. I don't know if you want to come back in on that particular point, but also on, I don't know if anybody else wants to come in, just talking about the investor confidence, because obviously it is a balance, I think we've heard that Willie Coffey mentioned before. But John, I don't know if you want to just address the point that Matt made around about that, and if anybody else wants to come in.
Yeah, no, I can understand the rationale about let's wait and see, but I'm really on working at the coalface. I see the impact that legislation and impending legislation is having on investor confidence today. And that's quite alarming for me to see that. So we've already seen a 7% reduction through landlord registration figures in the last 4 years. And I'm hearing every day of landlords saying, do you know what, my tenant's just given me 20 days notice to leave, which of course they can under the private residential tenancy. And now they are thinking, do you know what, maybe now's the time to sell this property. So for, you know, over 60% were citing the fear of impending legislation as being the motivating factor to actually sell, or the anti-government rhetoric, that the anti-landlord rhetoric that they're getting from the government. And we need to address that. We need to address how we can ensure that we've got a continual supply of housing in the private rented sector. And I'm concerned that we're not seeing that, and we'll just see a further reduction. From our figures, we could see a further reduction of conservatively 36,000 properties lost to the private rented sector over the next 10 years. And that's a big chunk of the sector just vanishing. Now, of course, those houses are still lived in by people, but they're being sold, and I imagine will continue to be sold to homeowners. So that's serving a need there. But what about renters? Some people will always have to rent and choose to rent. And we need to be able to make sure we've got an adequate supply for those renters going today as well as in the future.
Thanks for that. I suppose just a question, just supposed to understand the association's membership a little bit more. In terms of your membership, you said most of them maybe tend to have one or two properties. What's the approximate breakdown? You know, do you tend to have, as most own one or two properties? Are there bigger players in there who maybe own 15, 20 properties? Just to understand from that point of view, can you give us an approximate breakdown of your membership?
You can imagine, yeah, we've got a wide range of membership but the majority in Scotland do just own one or two properties. We know that through landlord registration statistics. So to memory, it's about 75% of the landlords in Scotland have under five properties. So that's your stereotypical landlord there. So they're not big corporate organisations. So they're relatively small investors who are, of course, at the mercy of legislation change. And that's not just about tenancy regime, it's about wider factors as well, too. And the pandemic, of course, has an effect on all of our lives. And many people have thought, you know what, the house sales market is incredibly buoyant. Maybe now this is a good time to bring forward the retirement plans. So that, of course, has an impact on supply of housing as well, too. So there's a whole range of factors that are actually impacting now. And I think we need to address that leaky bucket issue of these properties being lost to the rented sector today, rather than wait for that to, as I would see it, become an even bigger problem for the future.
Okay. Convener, can I bring in Andrew? I was keen to pick up a point that you mentioned. Andrew, you mentioned about the, obviously not just the Association of Landlords, but the PRS sector and the build-to-rent sector. I'm just keen to expand a little bit more on that and the evidence you had, because, again, I think we're talking about the landlords, but the build-to-rent sector obviously is a really important part of the, I suppose, the 10-year mix. So I don't know if you want to say a wee bit more around just the point you made about that particular sector.
Well, I think the survey that we carried out had very few responses from the build-to-rent sector, but that's to be expected, because actually that's representative of the build-to-rent sector in Scotland. It is still very, very anemic. There is a massive pipeline there, but pipelines don't mean houses that people can move into. So the position that we're in is that the PRS is the answer to all of the housing ills at the moment. And they've been asked to, you know, historically it was a transitory home for transitory populations, you know, students, young professionals. And now the regrowth of the sector over the last 20 years plus has seen it, you know, be an answer to every housing type and every type of household. And that's fine, but that naturally puts things at loggerheads, because we want to have the flexibility and we want to have the investment, but at the same extent, we want to have the governance structures that we might see with social housing and things. And there's a bit of work to make sure that we can fit all of that together. And I don't think it's as simple as it's drip feeding bits of legislation through. I think we need a much larger, more holistic plan for how this works and what we actually want the PRS to provide and how that dovetails and fits in with house building programmes, etc. But the investment case for small landlords is the same investment case as it is for the build to rent sector. And on the most part, I mean, there is some irrational behaviour amongst landlords. You know, they keep houses because they have a sentimental attachment to it, because it's attached to an area they used to live in. You know, these kind of strange financial decisions are made by landlords. On the whole, the majority of them are not willing to lose money in the long-term basis. They very much see the private rented sector as a bank account. Their capital is sitting safe. So the investment fundamental is there. The build-to-rent sector is obviously a lot more advanced in their analysis and their expectations and the research that they carried out. But it's very, very similar in terms of how the legislation impacts and affects them. And I think, returning to the point that I kind of made earlier, it's not simply looking at just this issue here. If we're trying to get investor confidence, it needs to look as if we're having this holistic approach to the PRS. So when I think about the context of changes recently, for example, removal of mortgage interest rate relief and then forthcoming changes in terms of energy efficiency, the new deal for tenants, rent control, it does genuinely worry me about what this will do to supply. And what our survey kind of found was that landlords are really disenfranchised with the sector. They feel under siege, and they view policymakers as being biased against them. Now, this may not be the case, and people may completely disagree with that characterisation, but the landlords that completed our forums and that took part in our interviews had a very strong feeling about this. And I think an important other contextual piece here is that the financial memorandum uses the annual rent figure of £8,300 to emphasise the rental return that landlords can receive. That's a bit of a red herring, because the actual rental income is not the headline figure. From an investment perspective, what we're really interested in is net yields and capital growth. Now, I'm working on another piece of research at the moment, not yet published, but it shows that...
Sorry, Mr. Watson, if you can draw... We've got other questions and really appreciate your responses. If you could just bring to a close, that would be great. Thank you.
I'll just quickly finish this bit on the yields, because I think it's quite important. So actually, the mean net yield and capital growth for landlords is very healthy. However, there's about a quarter of landlords had a net yield of 3% or lower, which is dangerously close to the best returns and savings accounts now, and about a third had a negative capital growth rate. So for all of our landlords who, you know, this isn't an issue, there's a big chunk of landlords that do not have a lot of wiggle room. So I think that's an important point to make.
Thank you for that. Just in the interest of time, we do have to get on, but I'm glad that you did make that point. I just want to see if Matt or Alistair would like to come in on any of Paul's line of questioning there. And if not, we'll move on. Alistair would like to come in, and then Matt.
Just very quickly, I think there's been a lot of discussion about the motivations and plannings undertaken by landlords, but I think that it's important that the private rented sector is not solely defined by those motivations and planning. As I've already said, that it is there in legislation that the private rented sector is meant to provide long-term permanent homes for tenants, and the landlord's interests obviously must be taken account of, because it is a sector that is needed, but it shouldn't be the overriding interest in conceptualising what the private rented sector is.
Thank you. And Matt?
Yes, and Alistair's made my point slightly already, but I think it's worth returning to what these proposals really are about, which is it's not about seeking, from my perspective, that private landlords would be disadvantaged or driven out of a market. It's simply that discretion allows for individual circumstances and support needs of tenants and actually of landlords to be taken into account, as opposed to that not always being the case. And that is a change, feels like a common sense move from our perspective, that should be, if it's a system that functions in the right way, actually to everyone's advantage. And to the extent to which landlords and landlord bodies feel like there's an agenda against them, I think that really should be dealt with seriously, if that's the way people feel, because we do need landlords in the private rented sector to function and to want to be in that market, and there are specific schemes that can help that, and it's only 50% of local authorities in Scotland that have a what we would see as a fully functional private rented sector access scheme. So there are things that really can be done to help landlords as well as tenants, but from our perspective, I think it's important to note that this isn't going to stop evictions. It's going to lead to some more common sense decision making where it doesn't currently already exist.
Thank you, Matt, for that. Thanks for bringing us back to what these proposals are about. I'm going to move on to questions from Graham Day.
Thank you, convener. Can I ask, probably best directed at John to start with, what evidence, if any, there is of the impact of the temporary introduction of the pre-action protocols? I'm thinking, for example, has it led to a reduction in rent arrears? Has it prevented applications for evictions being made to the tribunal?
The simple answer to that is we have no evidence of it, and I think that's been cited by other respondents to the consultation as well too. So we don't see evidence, and certainly anecdotally, speaking with our members, we're asking them, of course, they have to comply with the requirements, and we aid them in being able to do that and support them through that process. But we do ask them, you know, has it had an effect? And basically they're turning around saying, no, the tenants still do not communicate with us in the worst case scenarios. So it's not actually perhaps supporting those most in need. On record, obviously, we do support the continuation of it, because we see an advantage there in the sense of it provides clear guidance to landlords as to what they ought to be doing. It's a big question we've been asked by our members for years as to what do we do when a tenant gets into arrears? How do we communicate with them, etc., etc.? So the pre-action requirements goes a long way to supporting landlords and tenants get through perhaps the most difficult of times. But in reality, for the harder of the cases, you know, is it having an impact? We're not seeing the evidence.
But presumably the harder cases, it wouldn't have an impact on anyway.
Exactly. And that's why we would support it. You don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater, because you never know. In some cases, maybe that has encouraged the tenant to seek advice, or it's signposted them correctly, which is what that's in the interest of everyone, both landlord and tenant. One thing that I certainly would like to get across as a good news story is throughout the pandemic, we have seen great evidence of landlords and tenants working together to overcome the issues with rent arrears. And I think that's been really encouraging to see that. And perhaps that's resulted in a lot less cases of eviction going to the tribunal as well too. And anything we can do to continue that, and if pre-action requirements in some way aids that process, then that's fine. Let's not get rid of it for the sake of it. But what impact is it really having? We're unsure. And there's been no evidence, no research done on that as of yet.
Your point about being unsure, but perhaps it focuses minds, the very existence of it?
Exactly. Well, the whole idea, you know, we've, as an organisation, we support best practice in the sector. We want to encourage landlords to work with their tenants and build sustainable long-term relationships. That's in the landlord's interest as much as it is in the tenant's interest. So the pre-action requirements give some form of guidance to landlords to be able to say, in these circumstances, this is what you can say to your tenant, this is how you can signpost them. Is that a good thing? Of course, that's a good thing, and that's why we would support it.
Okay, anybody else want to come in on that? No? Okay, can I move this on then? Because some of the written evidence to the Parliament's call for views has suggested that the impact of the pre-action protocol is going to be quite limited because there's no duty on the landlord to comply with the protocol. But isn't it the case that landlords would be ill-advised not to comply with it in any case because of the consideration that will be given to the participation in this when it comes to any process that follows? I'm just seeing lots of nodding heads there, so probably not requiring to pursue that. Can I just...
John wanted to come in.
Apologies, Convener. John.
Yeah, just the 2020 regulations make it very, very clear that for an eviction case to be considered by the first-tier tribunal, they must take into consideration how the landlord has complied with the regulations. So, and I think certainly any landlord would be ill-advised to have completely ignored the pre-action requirements, because it certainly will result in probably them not getting that eviction that they're desiring. So, and not only that, as I was mentioning earlier, this is a good practice tool for every landlord and letting agent in the country too. So it can't be hailed as a bad thing, surely.
Thank you. Can I just one final question? We keep talking about this in relation to landlord participation. I'm a little bit unclear on everything I've read on this as to whether there's any kind of expectation on tenant participation in this process. Now, we're told that it will be a consideration for the tribunal if a landlord has failed to engage in it. Are we of the view that that would be a consideration against the tenant had failed to engage? Has anybody got a view on that? Alistair Houston, perhaps.
I think the issue with any pre-litigation requirements is that they are focused on the party who is bringing the litigation. So whether or not they are in the social sector and for heritable creditors as well, there's similar requirements. They are mandatory. They have to be completed, otherwise the action can't be brought. Now the exact amount of work that's maybe involved, if tenant or homeowner, as it would be in the repossession sector, participation is non-existent, then there is little that the party wanting to bring the litigation could do. Certainly, our experience that if a tenant does not participate, does not respond to attempts by a landlord to make contact, then in no way does the tribunal make any, there's no negative inference on the part of the landlord, and certainly it would be within the sphere of reasonableness for a tribunal to weigh that into the assessment of reasonableness against the tenant. I personally am in favour again of harmonisation, of seeing the action requirements being elevated to that mandatory status, so that they are a fixed set of requirements that all landlords would have to go through. And again, if they do not yield much participation, they are not a high hurdle for the landlord to overcome.
Anybody else want to come in on that?
Andrew Watson.
Quickly share some of the findings of the recent research, which was that about 95% of landlords who were in current arrears at the point of survey had attempted to engage with tenants, and around half of the tenants had responded. And around half of the time, repayment plans had been agreed, but only around half of the time had those been adhered to. So I think being realistic about how effective this can be is important, but I think it is very clear that, and you know, we all know the research clearly shows that early engagement with debt problems is the key to resolving those debt problems. So I think it's right to go ahead with this entirely. We just need to be realistic about the impact that it can have and monitor those in some way moving forward.
And Matt also wants to come in on this.
Yes, thank you. I think it's important to say that when in real life situations, it's not always the case that either that a tenant would be complying in the way that they should do. And I think we ought to be open and honest and say that. And sometimes important to note that from the balance of responsibilities, we need to take that into account. But I would also say that there are a number of cases where, particularly when it comes to rent arrears, there's not much the tenant can do. I was talking to a tenant the other day in Edinburgh who'd been placed by a local authority away from a domestic abuse perpetrator in a property she could not afford. And in that situation, the landlord wasn't doing the right thing. And we had to step in as a support agency to try and manage that situation. And that's why this system needs discretion. That's why this system needs probably also more requirements on local authorities to be able to refer, as John referred to, sort of the difficult cases, to a kind of homelessness prevention route, so that we don't go all the way through to somebody being evicted in a situation that could have been prevented beforehand. And I think it's just important to note that the individual circumstances are never cut and dried, and that's why the discretion is needed.
Thanks very much for those perspectives. I'm now going to bring in Mark Griffin, who's joining us on Blue Jeans with a couple of questions.
Thank you, Convener, and just draw members' attention to my register of interest as an owner of a private rented property in North Lanarkshire. Maybe can come to John first and just ask how aware he feels that tenants and landlords are of the current temporary requirements regarding the pre-action protocol, and do you think anything needs to be done to improve awareness of that?
It's certainly, obviously, as an organisation, it's something that we promote to our members and advise our members of through our helpline and our different ways of communicating with our members. I think more needs to be done about it, because obviously landlords are going to be really the first people to know that the tenant's in arrears, and they could be the crucial conduit to the tenant getting the all-important help that they need. So anything we can do to get more information to landlords in the wider public in Scotland would be really useful and beneficial there. And as with, I guess, most of situations around debt and rent arrears is no different, what we're trying to encourage both landlords and tenants to do is talk and just communicate with each other. often tenants at that point, when they get into arrears, is they don't talk to the landlords. They actually break down any communication that they have with the landlord. And we need to try and reverse that and encourage them to work with the landlords. And likewise, the landlords could often come to us and say, I don't know how to help the tenant. At the end of the day, the tenant needs to get money. If they've not got money, how do you solve this problem? And they're not aware of the different agencies and organisations that are out there that could support the tenants. So the pre-action requirements go some way to actually doing that. And I, you know, I do hope that they are, in at least some cases, beneficial to sustaining that relationship between the landlord and the tenant. But yeah, I take the point, certainly more information about it needs to be made available, certainly to landlords who are not members of an organisation like the Scottish Association of Landlords.
Thanks, John. Maybe if I could come to Matt as well, if you're able to give a perspective from any of the tenants that you're coming into contact with, whether there's a level of awareness of the pre-action protocols and their rights.
Yeah, thank you. And I totally agree with John. We do need to see more awareness. And I think that applies to tenants, it applies to landlords, also applies to local authority housing and homelessness teams. And I think that there is, just to bring in again, that the situation where only 50% of local authorities either commission out or have sufficient private rented sector access and other arrangements where they know the fullness of their private rented sector, then they intervene in the ways that they need to. There is a system here to knit together. And I think it's about, if it's a system that should be based on any principle, it should be the principle of prevention, a prevention of arrears, prevention of homelessness, prevention of difficulties for individuals. And the tenants that we speak to, I mean, almost nobody would understand that they have the sorts of protections that we're talking about in terms of technicalities here today. And that's the job of skilled individuals working with individual people and landlords to make them aware. And quite often the work we do match landlords and tenants in the right circumstances, because it's always the case that a tenancy might break down if those circumstances aren't right. So yeah, I completely agree with John, and it needs to be much more, I think, but following this bill's successful passage, communication with landlords and the tenants about what's available.
Thanks, Matt. If I come to my next question, is just to ask, and if anyone has a take on this, if you just click an add in the chat function, just ask if you think there needs to be any specific changes to the existing regulations, and perhaps if there's any change required in guidance to set out in more detail what's required under the pre-action protocol. Come to Alistair first.
Like I said, I think they should largely follow the procedure seen in the social sector, where they are set in mandatory pre-action requirements that have to be followed, and so are not factored into an assessment of reasonableness, but rather are mandatory procedural steps that have to be taken akin to service of a notice. I do, though, also agree with which has been said by John and Matt about awareness that and the role that the local authority could play, because I do appreciate that private landlords are not social landlords with their own welfare rights staff and such, and I think the local authorities could play a bigger role in terms of providing sources of information for agencies that tenants can be referred to try and achieve an outcome of for them of a sustainable tenancy, but also in the case of housing debt, for to assist in the landlord getting that debt repaid, and that if the requirements were strengthened, made mandatory, that would mean that in every case there should be a good standard of compliance.
Thanks, Alistair. I don't see anyone else requesting to speak, so I'll just hand back to you, Camilla.
Thank you, Mark. I'm now going to bring in Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Before I ask the questions that I've got left, because a lot of the questions have already been asked and answered, which is fantastic this morning, it's just to declare my interest that I am still a sitting councillor in East Ayrshire Council. So I'd like to direct my first question to Matt Downey. I know that crisis has promoted responsible use of the private rented sector for those who are homeless or at risk of homelessness for many, many years. As we've already heard, we know that year on year, pre-pandemic eviction levels from the private rented sector exceeded those of the socially rented sector. Matt, how do you think the proposals contained in this section of the bill will address this? And do you feel it captures all of the recommendations and outputs that we've seen from the reconvened HARSAG Homelessness and Rough Sleeping Action Group and the Social Renewal Advisory Board, especially now that we're facing the additional pressures of the cost of living crisis?
Yes, thank you. So, yes, the proposals in the bill in part four are absolutely in line with the Homelessness Rough Sleeping Action Group and the Social Renewal Board. They're also in line with the Prevention Review Group and the proposals that are being consulted on by Scottish Government on homelessness prevention itself. And I think they work, but they have to work together. And I think that it's a set of things that are interlinked that are about the sensible protection of balanced rights for tenants and landlords. I think that the here and now of the situation is serious. Every single local authority in Scotland is expecting an increase in the need to prevent homelessness out of the private rented sector, according to our survey in the Scottish Homelessness Monitor. We know every day in our services that people are coming to us with severe needs in terms of rent arrears, and the increased cost of living is exacerbating that. And so there may be arguments for delay in some cases, technicalities for how it might work, but there's no argument for delay in terms of human need as far as we can see it. So in that sense, this absolutely completes the picture, and we do need to make sure that the pre-action protocol is people are aware of it and it works. We need to make sure that private landlords are reached and supported and incentivised by some of the supports that's available from East Ayrshire and other councils out there, that is really important in sustaining their place in the market. But for us, this is part of COVID recovery that makes sure that homelessness prevention is at the heart of it, and that's why we support it, because we shouldn't have to see people reaching the kind of the very edge of homelessness before they get support and before their homelessness rights kick in. What people have told us time and again is that what they would rather is that they had the choices that people who don't have to have a homelessness application have in front of them. And that means being able to speak to your landlord, being able to work out a different path. And maybe it means a different tenancy sometimes. Maybe it means prevention and through some other route. But this is a significant step forward from our perspective, should it go through, and we fully support it.
Thanks very much for that. I don't know if anybody else wanted to come in on that or not. Nope. Thank you, Matt. I'll move on to the second question I've got and the final question I have. And I would like to direct it to John Blackwood, if I can. During the height of the pandemic, we did meet in the private rented sector resilience group that was set up at the time. And I'm really glad to hear that anecdotally there was a great support for the fact that landlords working hand in hand with tenants to do that prevention work, because we did speak about that a lot at the time, and to get that kind of support information out. How do you think, I know this has already been touched on, but how do you think that we could improve upon that going forward? Because my committee, the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, at the moment have an open inquiry about problem debt and poverty, and we know that people that are in that situation often find it really difficult to engage in services at times. You've got members, and obviously there's members across the country who aren't members of your association, landlords. How do we actually join up all those services so that the support agencies and the councils and the landlords can work cross-sector to prevent homelessness as far upstream as we can?
Well, I think going back to the pre-action requirements, when they were introduced, of course, it was a part of the emergency measures that needed to come in to deal with an emerging pandemic. And I guess as we're looking, as hopefully we go out the pandemic into stage of it being endemic, and if these pre-action requirements continue, I think we do need to look at them again and think, what purpose do they serve? I think we all probably could agree they do have a purpose, but in what shape or form should that be going forward? And are we at the beginning of the pandemic? I have to be honest and say, you know, certainly I had concerns about massive rent arrears being built up, as everybody did. And of course, landlords having no alternative but to apply for eviction. That didn't happen. And that was a good news story. We were delighted with that. And actually, the reason that we can see as to why it didn't happen is because landlords and tenants did work together. I think everybody understood that although they had very different vested interests and came from different viewpoints in that landlord-tenant relationship, they were keen to work together to sustain the tenancy. And they appreciated that everybody was going through a difficult time. And I think just that with both parties approaching it from a point of view of, well, let's see how we can work it out. Let's see how we can solve the problem. That, I think, was terrific. And I think resulted in a good outcome for everyone. But often when somebody gets into rent arrears, for whatever reason, very quickly the relationship between the landlord and the tenant breaks down. And that results in the landlord feeling that they are the wronged party, they have nowhere to go for help, and they have no alternative but to go for eviction. So I'm optimistic that in the future, if we look at the exact detail of the free action requirements, we can refine them in a way to make them more user-friendly for situations that might arise in the future. And often that could be just appropriate signposting. Maybe that's all that's needed in the very early stages of intervention. As you well know, as rent arrears get higher, that difficulty increases, and of course the tenants hide their head in the sand and just feel there's no way out of this, there's no solution. So we need to intervene early in that difficult situation between the landlord and the tenant. And I'm hopeful that perhaps a refinement, shall we say, of the pre-action requirements going forward actually might achieve that. Certainly lots of landlords, when they look at them, they say, what does all this mean? It's a lot of bits of paper, processes you need to go through. How user-friendly is it? I think there are big questions over that. But it had to be brought in quickly at the time when it did. But I think now is probably the time for us to look at the detail of the requirements and make sure we get the right information to the right people when they need it.
Thank you very much. Nothing further from me, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Elena. I've got one final question, and I'm going to kind of keep you on the screen, John, because it's for you. Can you explain your concerns about the removal of Eviction Ground 8 from Schedule 5 of the Housing Scotland Act 1988? So getting a bit technical there.
It is a bit technical, and it was just with regard, it's just to flag it up as an issue, and perhaps there might be a requirement for transitionary measures to be brought in here. I can completely understand that, of course, if all grounds are going to be discretionary, then what is the point in having ground 8 in the 88 Act? And I completely understand the thinking behind it. However, what we are conscious of is landlords could today be issuing eviction on ground 8, and if they came to us, they would get advice, don't just do it on ground 8, use 11 and 12 as well too, as cited in our response to the consultation. But beyond that, you know, I think, you know, there is a risk we run by taking away completely. If notice has been given to use that ground today, it could well be a year before that case comes before the first tier tribunal. And of course, that landlord, assuming this receives royal assent over the summer, the landlord might not be able to rely on that ground going forward. So I think at the very least, some consideration should be given to transitionary measures to protect the landlord's interests when using ground 8 in the meantime. That's really where we're coming from with that. And even actually, to be perfectly honest, leaving it as it is without repealing it would have no impact on the actual policy intention of the legislation before you. So we don't think it would have a negative impact just to keep it.
Thanks very much for that response. That was great. And I just also wanted to come back and say thank you also for the painting of the picture you gave in response to Eleanor's question around how everybody really did pull together and, you know, try to find the solutions here. And I think, you know, we are trying to find the rays of hope or the chinks of light that came out of the pandemic. And clearly that was something that, you know, people were pushed into a situation where everybody had to play their part and find a solution that worked. So I'm going to bring the session to a close unless anyone on the panel does have a final remark they want to make. We do have a little bit more time, but very brief, nothing more. No shakings of the heads. Well, thank you so much for joining us this morning. I think the evidence you've given to the committee has been very helpful in helping us consider our next steps. And I am now going to suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses.
Good morning, Greg Walker at Susan in Broadcasting.
We now turn to our second stage evidence session on part four of the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill, for which we are joined by the Minister for Carbon Buildings, Active Travel and Tenants' Rights. Mr. Harvey is joined today by Scottish Government officials, Greg Walker, who's the Bill team leader, I think, who's joining us online, Yvonne Gavin, who is from the Private Housing Services and is the team leader, and Craig McGuffey, who is the lawyer. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting, and as Mr. Walker is joining us remotely, I'd be grateful if Mr. Harvey would make clear if he wishes him to respond to a specific question to allow broadcasting to bring him in. I tend to allow up to 75 minutes for this discussion, but before I open up to questions from the committee, I now invite Mr. Harvey to make a short opening statement.
Well, thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to yourself and the committee, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to say a few words at the start about the tenancy provisions in the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Bill. Obviously, a word of thanks also to everyone, individuals and organisations who engaged in the consultation process, which has helped inform the development of the bill, and for the comments, indeed, from those who provided a response to the committee's call for evidence as well. A few words first about the general overview of the bill itself, before turning in more detail to the tenancy provisions. The Scottish Government's priorities are to continue to lead Scotland safely through and out of the COVID pandemic and to address the inequalities that have been made worse by COVID, progressing toward a wellbeing economy and accelerating inclusive, person-centred public services. As part of learning lessons from the pandemic, the Government is committed to reviewing the impact of COVID on the Scottish statute book. The bill extends to around 30 different topics, most of which are being scrutinised by the COVID-19 Recovery Committee or other subject committees. In relation to the tenancy provisions in particular, then, Part 4 relates to eviction from properties in the private rented sector, and the effects of the coronavirus pandemic have quite undoubtedly led to a reduction in income for many households across Scotland. And we know that some of the most vulnerable, financially vulnerable citizens in Scotland do live in the private rented sector. The impact of the pandemic, both in the immediate and longer term, mean that some private tenants are finding themselves in significant financial difficulty. In recognition of this, the two emergency coronavirus acts from 2020 introduced a number of key provisions to protect tenants, and we're now looking to make two of these permanent because we believe they have improved fairness in the system, better balanced the needs of tenants and landlords, and explicitly given tenants support when it's most needed. So the first is private landlord pre-action protocols in relation to evictions on the grounds of rent arrears. The second is to ensure that all eviction cases going before the first tier tribunal, Housing and Property Chamber, are considered on a discretionary basis, when previously some eviction grounds would result in a mandatory eviction order being issued. Looking at the pre-action protocol provisions first, these formalise the steps that a private landlord should take to support a tenant who's fallen into rent arrears, and to do so as early as possible. This aims to ensure that all steps have been taken to sustain a tenancy before the landlord takes action to evict. It sets out three key areas of action a landlord should take to support a tenant in rent arrears. Firstly, for landlords to give tenants clear information regarding their rights in relation to eviction, how they can access information on financial support and debt management, and an overview of their tenancy agreement. And the second action is for landlords to make reasonable efforts to agree with the tenant a reasonable repayment. And the third action is for the landlord also to give reasonable consideration to the steps that the tenant has taken. The tribunal has to take into account the landlord's compliance with this pre-action protocol when deciding whether to issue an eviction order or not. Pre-action protocols have been in place in the social rented sector for a number of years, and so making this provision permanent for the private rented sector is an important step toward ensuring the parity of rights across the rental sector that the Scottish Government wants to see. during the bill's consultation, some private landlords and their representative bodies advised that they already take this action to support a tenant who's fallen into rent arrears. So this provision formalises what is already seen to be best practice by professional landlords within the sector. The second provision is ensuring in all cases going before the first tier tribunal, that eviction is only ordered where it is reasonable to do so. All eviction grounds therefore become discretionary. Prior to the emergency legislation, if eviction was being sought on certain grounds, such as 3 or more consecutive months in rent arrears, the tribunal were obliged to issue an eviction order. By ensuring that every ground of eviction is discretionary, we ensure that the tribunal is able to consider all relevant factors in eviction cases and determine whether eviction is reasonable in those circumstances. This would include consideration of whether a private landlord has undertaken all the steps they should have as part of the pre-action protocol, or any proactive steps a tenant may be taking to reduce rent arrears. And again, it's worth highlighting that similar provisions have been in place in the social sector for many years. Convener, I'm aware of the responses received during the 12-week consultation for the bill and in the committee's own call for evidence. And diverging views do exist on the tenancy provisions that we're seeking to make permanent. Tribunal discretion, in particular, is seen by some private landlords as creating an unfair balance of rights between tenant and landlord. Private landlords argue that this provision could drive up costs, increase risk, and dent investor confidence. It's important to note that the tenancy provisions do not prevent a private landlord from seeking to recover possession of their property. Instead, the provisions introduce additional layers of protection simply to ensure that all avenues have been exhausted in sustaining a tenancy and that the eviction itself is reasonable given the individual circumstances of the case. The tribunal having discretion allows it to take into account all the circumstances, both of the tenant and the landlord, to come to a fair and appropriate conclusion. Conversely, tenant representative groups have strongly welcomed our intention to introduce the private landlord pre-action protocol and tribunal discretion on a permanent basis. You'll be aware that organisations such as Shelter Scotland, Citizens Advice Scotland, Living Rent, Public Health Scotland and Police Scotland support this move, highlighting that the negative financial impacts of COVID are ongoing and that the tenancy provisions will help to deliver a recovery from the impact of the pandemic. And indeed, Shelter Scotland specifically state that tribunal discretion provisions will disproportionately impact for the better on people with lower incomes and help to deliver a wellbeing economy. So, Convener, Part 4 of the Bill supports the Scottish Government's COVID recovery strategy and our overall objective of addressing the harms caused by the pandemic and tackling systematic inequalities made worse by the pandemic. It also supports the Government's draft rented sector strategy on which, as you'll be aware, we're currently consulting, and that aims to deliver a new deal for tenants, giving them more secure, stable, affordable tenancies with improved standards of accommodation, new controls on rent, and more flexibility to personalise their homes. And we've already committed to bringing forward a new housing bill in the second year of this Parliament to deliver on some of the legislative commitments contained within the strategy. In conclusion, Convener, as I said at the beginning, many of those people living in the private rented sector are among some of the most financially vulnerable in our society. And in particular, this applies to people who have an income but are still living in poverty due to the longer term impact of the pandemic, coupled with ever increasing living costs. And I think we're all painfully aware that that situation may continue to be exacerbated. Making these tenancy provisions permanent will therefore provide an important extra layer of security for those households, as well as helping to ensure a parity of right for renters, whether they're renting from the private or the social rented sector. And I would also emphasise that these provisions still enable landlords to recover possession of their property in circumstances where a tenancy is genuinely unsustainable. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister, for laying out very clearly to the committee the intentions of this legislation making these two pieces permanent in part four of the bill. I'm going to open up to questions, and I'd like to begin by asking you how the reforms presented today fit into the programme of work outlined in the New Deal for Tenants consultation and forthcoming housing bill, and what more needs to be done to increase awareness among tenants.
Thank you. I mean, to take the first part, the New Deal for Tenants consultation launched in December did make clear that we have more work to do to strengthen the rights of tenants and improve the quality of the private rented sector. It included the two changes that we're considering today, and I think that's very consistent with the direction of travel more broadly toward a private rented sector that has more comparable rights compared with the social rented sector. So to have those provisions in place now and then fail to make them permanent would mean, I think, a degree of confusion both for landlords and for tenants if we were then to seek to revisit the question in the Year 2 Housing Bill. I think the learning that we have very clearly from the exercise of these provisions on a temporary basis is that they do provide an additional level of protection. They don't have any, we consider that any, you know, negative consequences are extremely slight and entirely reasonable. The costs, for example, I think are pretty low in terms of if tribunal takes a little longer to consider the circumstances of an individual case where there's discretion if there previously hadn't been. Those kind of any negative consequences are extremely slight compared with the strong advantages of having this additional level of protection. So the clear argument is to make these provisions permanent now rather than to go through a period of allowing them to lapse and then considering reintroducing them again in the Year 2 bill. As for awareness, I think that's an extremely significant issue which will never go away. Because we know that the private rented sector is something in which landlords ebb and flow over the years, people move in and out of the sector, and tenants, of course, move in and out of the sector all the time, and in particular, a great many younger people in their first home might be in the private rented sector. I think there will always be an ongoing need to ensure a high level of awareness of rights and of the law as it stands to protect people in the private rented sector. We are currently partway through a tenant rights awareness raising campaign, and that's been a really important way to give people some very, very basic facts in the top line messages, but also point them in the direction of much more significant and detailed information should they need it. And we also, of course, work closely with organisations like Crisis and Shelter Scotland, who work much more closely with those tenants who need the additional level of support that they can provide. But yeah, the issue of awareness is probably one that will never go away. We're always going to need to keep making sure that those people who are moving into the private rented sector, both as landlords and as tenants, become aware of their rights and obligations.
Thanks for that response. It's good to, yes, of course, the sector is a fluid sector with people coming and going. And actually, just to kind of like what kind of rises up in my mind in that, in your response, is that, I mean, this is like looking to other countries. Is the private rented sector a common thing in other countries? How do other countries do it? Like we see that private rented sector and the social rented sector and that combination in Scotland is normal. But is that normal, say, in the Netherlands, or do they tend to go down the line of more socially provided housing? Is there always a mix in other countries?
Well, I mean, I suppose if we were certainly to look in the European context, there's always a mix, but the mix is different in different contexts. Germany, for example, has a much bigger private rented sector, but has had some of the rights and protections that we're seeking to explore and develop in the Year 2 Housing Bill already in place for quite some time. In some European countries, there would be very little difference in the rights and protections that tenants have between what we would call the social and the private rented sector. And the distinction between who is the housing provider as a private organisation or a social organisation doesn't have the significant impact on the different experience of the tenants as it does in this country. But as I say, the consultation on the New Deal for Tenants and the development of the Year 2 Housing Bill, I think, is going to be informed by consideration of all of those examples and experiences from other contexts.
Thank you very much for that. I'm going to follow up with another question. So some respondents to the Parliament's call for views on the bill thought that the proposals could negatively affect investor confidence and the supply of privately rented homes, and you touched on this a little bit in your opening. What estimate have you made on the impact of these changes on the supply of privately rented accommodation?
Well, we have, of course, engaged extensively on the provisions within the bill. I touched in my opening remarks on the consultation that took place. It's possible that making all eviction grounds discretionary could lead to some increase in costs for landlords in certain circumstances. As I mentioned earlier, if the consideration of a particular case takes a little longer, for example, due to the need to take individual circumstances into account. But we think it's highly unlikely to lead to significant additional costs to landlords. And on the pre-action protocol provisions, I think the Scottish Association of Landlords have made the point during the consultation that many landlords already take this course of action to support tenants in rent arrears. And so compliance with these would not increase costs at all, or even increase the amount of work or the actions that are necessary for those who do follow best practice. It would have the additional advantage of encouraging and requiring that good practice by those who previously haven't, but we don't believe that would create any significant additional costs for landlords.
Thank you for that. We're now going to bring in Graham Day with a question.
Thank you. Morning, Minister. One of the key issues of the debate on the introduction of the private residential tenancy was to ensure a balance between the rights of tenants and landlords. And that's why some eviction grounds remain mandatory. How does the proposal to make all eviction grounds discretionary retain an appropriate balance between the rights of tenants and landlords?
Well, I think most fundamentally, and put it at the simplest level, it allows the tribunal to consider all of the circumstances relating to the landlord and the circumstances relating to the tenant. Landlords are, of course, if tribunal discretion is made permanent, if the committee agrees with our proposal, landlords will still be able to pursue eviction where they believe it's necessary. It doesn't fundamentally end or curtail those rights of landlords, but being able to take into account the individual circumstances, including those caused by the pandemic, but not limited to those, will provide a far fairer balance of rights for everybody involved. I think in your earlier evidence session, for example, the example was given of a private tenant who had to be moved in order to escape an abusive or a violent situation at home and faced additional costs because of the price of the property they were moved into. That kind of circumstance needs to be taken into account and understood. There'll be others which members, I'm sure, from all parts of the country will recognise from our own constituency and regional work of people, for example, in a rural area where there's very little alternative housing available, and you know, even if a landlord has a reasonable case to make, they also need to balance that against the reasonable experience of the tenant if no alternative housing is available. So those individual circumstances need to be balanced. They need to be taken into account. And we believe that giving discretion to take into account the individual circumstances on all grounds will allow that proper balance to be struck. And has done during the period when the emergency legislation has been in force.
So, Vimy, can I just seek some clarity on a point that I raised with the earlier panel? Because it's not clear in anything I've read. When the tribunal was sitting making a judgment in cases, is the discretion that it has sufficient that a circumstance in which perhaps the landlord had followed fully or sought to follow fully the pre-action protocol, but a tenant had ignored all such approaches, and there were no reasonable grounds for that having been, not the kind of circumstances you've touched upon earlier, would the panel, the tribunal, have the discretion to take into account the fact that the tenant had not engaged in attempts to find a resolution?
The requirement to comply with the pre-action protocol rests with the landlord. It requires them to take reasonable steps. If a landlord takes those reasonable steps and is met with a tenant who won't engage, then they have clearly still met that test of making those reasonable steps, making those efforts to make information available, to explore repayment schedule, for example. If they've made those efforts, then they've clearly met that test, and that circumstance would be taken into account under tribunal discretion.
That take account of the fact that the tenant, perhaps with no good reason, had failed to engage as well. Is there two sides to this, is my question?
Yes, well, I mean, I guess the ideal that we're looking for is to increase the number of situations in which an alternative route is found, an alternative resolution is found. And if a landlord makes those approaches and a tenant engages constructively, then hopefully they would never need to reach the tribunal in the first place, because they would find another way of resolving the situation and sustaining the tenancy, which is what we're looking to achieve. I suppose, you know, it seems fairly clear that if a landlord has gone through those steps and been unable to engage properly with their tenant, and that the tenant has refused to do so, that's clearly a circumstance that the tribunal would be able to take into account.
Thank you. I'm now going to move to questions from Willie Coffey, who's joining us on Blue Jeans.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Minister, and to your colleagues. The Landlords Association told us that the temporary change made all the evictions discretionary, really had little impact on the tribunal refusing an eviction order. Could you say a few words about this? I mean, if that's the case, why would changing it to make it a permanent arrangement actually benefit tenants?
Well, yes, thank you. The Scottish Association of Landlords have put forward some figures in their submission suggesting that the number of cases in which discretionary grounds being mandatory during the emergency legislation having altered the outcome is very small. I think it's really important to recognise that the impact on those small number of cases is extremely significant. And even if a relatively small number of people see a different outcome to their tribunal case, the impact on their lives is going to be extremely significant. But I think the deeper point, and perhaps the bigger impact of this, is the one that's harder to measure, which is the cases that don't go to tribunal in the first place. If a landlord, for example, who previously might have thought, I'm going to the tribunal on grounds which are mandatory, grounds which would result in a mandatory determination for an eviction order, and that's now discretionary, if they reach the view themselves that they haven't gone through a reasonable course of action, that the individual circumstances of seeking that eviction are not reasonable, then they'd be more likely to not proceed with that eviction in the first place. And actually, a little bit like what I was saying to Graham Day, what we're looking for is to maximise the opportunities for a negotiated outcome, a reasonable settlement, and for action to be taken that can sustain a tenancy rather than end one. And again, whether it's about requiring the pre-action protocol, these reasonable steps of engagement, or it's about ensuring that landlords know that they're more likely to result in some kind of resolution if they try to sustain the tenancy rather than going straight for eviction, then we're likely to see a sector that does see the resolution of any problems like this as the first option. And as I say, this is good practice already in relation to the private rented sector. Those landlords who follow best practice will already be going through these steps and would not pursue eviction if they thought there was any chance that that a tribunal might consider the circumstances unreasonable.
Thanks for that, Patrick. In terms of the pre-action protocols that have been mentioned through the meeting. Some of the respondents to has also said there was little evidence to support the positive impact that they actually had. Can you share a few words with us about how you see that? I mean, did these measures actually help us to reduce overall rent arrears, or did they prevent eviction orders going to the tribunal and so on and so forth? So could you say a few words for that around that for us, please?
Yeah, absolutely. And again, this is a question that might be a little hard to quantify, a little hard to put precise or objective numbers on, because the nature of the pre-action protocols means that they're undertaken prior to taking any action to the tribunal. So we wouldn't necessarily have official statistics as such on where those actions led to a successful resolution of the problem. But given that there has been an overall reduction in the number of eviction cases seen by the tribunal over the course of the pandemic, I think it's fair to say that this provision has contributed to supporting tenants and landlords to achieve that kind of positive resolution to these problems and to sustain a tenancy. So, for example, where tenants have been able to secure additional sources of financial support as a result of the signposting that the landlord undertakes during the pre-action protocol, this would clearly help them to resolve that situation. The Tenant Hardship Grant Fund, for example, which committee will be well aware of, would be one source of additional support that's been there during the pandemic, as well as discretionary housing payments, other forms of money advice and financial advice that a tenant might be able to access from the voluntary sector or community organisations. If the landlord is actively signposting a tenant in these circumstances, then it may well end up that this becomes a case we never have to count. And I think that we should see that as a positive.
Absolutely, I can see that. So the formalising of it, that gives us a kind of consistency of practice across the sector, so that basically tenants get the same treatment right across the board.
Yes, indeed. I mean, it not only closes that gap between the social and private rented sector by making something which has been permanent in the social rented sector a permanent feature of the private rented sector too. It also, as the Scottish Association of Landlords made clear in their evidence, simply normalises what they consider already to be best practice. And I think that's consistent with the general direction of travel. What we're looking to achieve in terms of the private rented sector more generally is to close the gap in the outcomes that people have depending on where they're renting, and also to raise standards across the board. I think this measure is getting pretty much across the board support, probably because it's pretty clear that it's going to achieve that objective.
Okay. Thanks for that, Patrick. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. I'm now going to move to questions from Paul McClellan.
Yeah, thank you, Convener, and morning, Minister and panel. Just want to touch a little bit more on the pre-action protocol. A few questions around about that. One was obviously some written evidence had suggested that the impact of the pre-action protocol would be limited, as there's no duty on the landlord to comply with the protocol. Probably the question is, you know, why is there not that legal duty? And I suppose, and would a legal duty not ensure greater compliance?
I saw the discussion on this as well as part of your earlier evidence session. And I think if I remember rightly, John Blackwood from the Scottish Association of Landlords said that a landlord would be poorly advised to pursue a request for eviction, taking that to the tribunal, if they hadn't gone through this, because there's the expectation that the tribunal would consider the landlord's compliance with that as part of their consideration. What we're looking to do is to make permanent the temporary provisions that were put in place during the pandemic, and making that permanent is the simplest and cleanest way to achieve that continuation. We might be able to consider at some future point, perhaps in the year two housing bill, whether there are wider views, if the evidence that we gather from between now and then shows that the protocol should be amended to create a greater legal duty to ensure compliance, then we could consider that. But at this point, we have temporary provisions in place. Making those permanent is the cleanest and simplest way to ensure that we retain this additional level of protection. And I think it's pretty clear that we can have confidence that any landlord that does feel the need and genuinely believes that in the circumstances they are acting reasonably to pursue an eviction will have gone through these pre-action protocol steps in the first place in order to demonstrate to the tribunal that their actions are reasonable.
And the follow-up for that is, and again, the Scottish Government's already introduced financial support measures, including the tenant hardship grant, to support tenants throughout the pandemic. I suppose the key thing, and I think that's been very gratefully received, will the Scottish Government provide any financial support to tenants to support the recovery from the pandemic as we come out of that? Because obviously it's not just going to be a click overnight kind of thing, so just if that's been considered.
Yes, indeed. The grant fund is focused on helping those tenants who are struggling financially. And I think it would be fair to say that given the current circumstances more widely than just the operation of the private rented sector, we're all very conscious that the cost of living crisis is already severe and may continue to be exacerbated. Some of the actions that we can consider will go beyond my brief, and I know that the Social Justice Cabinet Secretary wrote to councils in December and also followed that up again just last week, reiterating that payments from the Tenant Hardship Grant Fund should be made to those who are in the most financial need and facing the risk of homelessness, in particular those in the private rented sector who may be at risk of eviction. There are those in the social sector whose already low incomes have been hit hard by the pandemic, and they can also get help with this scheme. But as part of the pre-action protocol, landlords should be making tenants who are at risk of losing their home due to rent arrears aware of all of these forms of financial support available, not just the tenant grant fund. I think it's fair to say as well that there'll continue to be ongoing debate across the whole Parliament and across a number of different portfolios within government to ensure that we try to take the maximum and the most ambitious approach that we can to supporting people through the cost of living crisis. And that will apply to people with a housing brief, but it will certainly go beyond that.
Thanks, Minister. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. I want to bring in Graham Day with a supplementary on this issue.
Thank you, Convener. You're right, Minister John Blackwood, the Scottish Association of Landlords, was quite positive about this, but he did also, I think, suggest that they would be keen to perhaps have a dialogue around around the refinement perhaps of the protocol, around some of the detail and also how it was presented. Is that something you'd be open to?
Yes, indeed. And I think the fact that we're at the point of having temporary provisions, we're seeking to make those permanent now, but we have a housing bill, a live consultation right now, but also a housing bill expected to be introduced in year two of the Parliament, actually gives us the opportunity to continue with the current system that's been put in place on a temporary basis, continue to gain evidence and understanding and learn from experience of its operation, and that will inform any consideration of proposals to refine or adjust in the year two housing bill.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for that, and I'd like to bring in Megan Gallagher.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, Minister, and good morning, panel. We've spoken a little bit this morning about the workload of the Tribunal, and we know during the pandemic there was a decrease over the number of applications for eviction orders during the pandemic period, and that would be expected. But I would like to ask whether, as we manoeuvre out of the pandemic, if the workload would therefore increase again, and will cases take longer to consider?
Thank you. It is, of course, up to the Tribunal to decide what circumstances they take into account, and that, of course, would determine how long a case might take to consider. So it's possible that some cases would take longer to consider, whether a particularly exceptional or unusual circumstances, but that obviously won't always be the case. The evidence that we have to date does suggest that this effect will be modest. And my view is that the most important impact is of ensuring that most tenancy exits don't go to the tribunal, and you know, recognising that, but also recognising the intention of this to encourage negotiation and agreement between tenants and landlords where there's a problem. I think if we're successful in doing that, and I think the evidence shows that the temporary provisions have been successful in doing that, then any additional burdens of workload will be manageable, and the effect would be modest. The financial memorandum that accompanies the bill also explores the costs to the tribunal in greater detail, and where there are quantifiable costs to decision to discretionary decision making, it's worth noting that the introduction of the pre-action protocol and the tribunal being obliged to consider a landlord's compliance with it before making the decision will again reinforce that it's in the landlord's best interest to engage with a tenant early to prevent arrears from building up in the first place. And again, that early engagement could prevent the need for eviction proceedings altogether, which ultimately would reduce the costs on the tribunal.
Thank you. Can I just expand a little bit on the term that you used there, modest, in relation to the backlog that could come in on the back of this? And, you know, does the Scottish Government expect there to be a backlog in terms of whether or not this bill has progressed?
I think when I used the word modest, I was referring to any increase in costs of consideration of individual cases. I think we're all very aware, as some of your witnesses in the earlier session were, that there is a significant concern across a number of different local authorities about the scale of rent arrears that have been built up during the pandemic, and that's why we're so committed to ensuring that that range of financial support is available. Not only the Tenant Hardship Grant Fund, but the £82 million that's been provided for DHP to support mitigation of the bedroom tax and housing costs, additional funding to local authorities to ensure that they have the resources available to support people in their areas. We have a range of support and intervention measures in response to the pandemic itself. And the additional funding that's been passed in this year's budget to ensure that we're supporting people with their housing costs. I don't think there's any getting away from the fact that the impact of the pandemic financially on people has not yet fully played out, and that happening in the context of the wider cost of living crisis is going to be a challenging period for tenants and for landlords, as well as for the organisations working to support them. But I think the provision, the permanence of the provisions in this bill will help to ensure that the greatest opportunity is taken to resolve disputes between landlords and tenants constructively, and to avoid the need for eviction proceedings wherever that can be done and tenancies can be sustained.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. We're now going to move on to questions from Mark Griffin, who's joining us on Blue Jeans.
Thanks, Kabina. Good morning, Minister. I just wanted to ask what the Government's view is on whether there will be any impact of the Bill's proposals on local authority homelessness services, and to ask the Minister's view on how he thinks the proposals link into the Scottish Government plans to improve homelessness prevention.
Thank you very much. I mean, this is hugely important. Of course, there have been periods when evictions in the private rented sector were the most significant, the largest route into homelessness. That has perhaps declined proportionately, but there is a real concern and a desire to make sure that that doesn't become the scale of a problem that Mark Griffin is concerned about, rightly concerned about. The pre-action protocol and the tribunal discretion provisions are both safeguards that I think can help to prevent eviction into homelessness. The protocol in particular encourages and supports that dialogue I referred to earlier between landlords and tenants to work toward establishment of repayment plans to help clear rent arrears and sustain a tenancy, and to make sure that tenants have access to the financial support that can also help them. And the organisations that you'll have heard from have made similar points. Shelter in particular say that the pre-action requirements for eviction proceeding on grounds of rent arrears introduce an important preventative measure for eviction and homelessness. This extra protection for renters against eviction should be made permanent. Pre-action protocols encourage landlords to help their tenants access the support and advice on rent arrears management before eviction action is taken, helping them to manage their debt and remain in their homes. So I think there's a pretty clear sense from the organisations that work most closely on homelessness and rightly challenge the government to continue to look to do more on homelessness prevention, that these measures will be a positive step in that direction. By no means suggesting that they are the only steps that we need to take, but they'll certainly be positive in helping to achieve that.
Yeah, thanks for that, Minister. I also wanted to ask about some of the provisions in the temporary coronavirus legislation that aren't being taken forward on a permanent basis in this new piece of legislation, specifically around extended notice periods that landlords need to give tenants to end their tenancy, and also in the ban on evictions. Just ask what discussion or debate there's been within government around continuing to make the extended notice periods permanent, and any discussion around aspects of a ban on evictions in certain circumstances.
Thank you. This is obviously a hugely important question, and it is one that we've actively considered within government. There were four key measures during the pandemic, two of which we're discussing making permanent today. The others were the eviction ban that came to an end last year as areas dropped out of tiers 3 and 4, and the, as Mark Griffin says, the extended notice periods that came to an end at the end of this month. Albeit, I would note that we have put in place transitional protection for tenants who are already facing action. The emergency legislation that was put in place was a temporary public health protection measure. And in putting forward legislation of this nature, the government needs to demonstrate the requirement for it, demonstrate the need for it. And it was on the basis of public health protection, aimed at ensuring that people could stay safe in their homes for as long as possible in those unprecedented circumstances of the pandemic. Just because a measure isn't being retained right now doesn't mean that the logic of it is lost. And so the New Deal consultation that we have ongoing at the moment asks for views on winter evictions and also on reviewing the grounds in the private residential tenancy. So the experience that we've had during the pandemic will inform those reforms. But the provisions that we put forward need to be demonstrated as being necessary and proportionate on their own terms, and simply extending those when the pandemic circumstances themselves don't pertain isn't an automatic given. We believe that in the case of the two provisions that we are seeking to make permanent, the experience is very clear that this will have an ongoing value, and also that it is proportionate and reasonable as a means of achieving the government's legitimate policy objectives of reducing the gap in outcomes between private and rented, private and social rented sectors, and also raising standards across the private rented sector. If we seek to make changes in relation to the issues that Mark Griffin has raised, we will do so as a result of the consultation that's currently underway and in the proper development of a full bill on housing in year two. I hope that's enough to answer Mr. Griffin's question.
Yeah, thanks, Minister. Thanks, Camilla.
Thank you. Yes, I think that was a good answer and really illuminated for the committee why you weren't taking that piece forward. I'd like to bring in Miles Briggs with some questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to your officials as well. I wanted to go back to where we started, really, with regards to rationale for doing this, because I think in a number of your answers, you've described different work streams which are currently out to consultation or potentially will be launched next year. So I just wanted to look at the fact that analysis of the consultation on this bill does show that majority of responders were opposed to these proposals, and why you've, the government's decided to bring them forward when in fact next year this could be an opportunity to look at this and widen it out potentially to further things within housing. It seems a bit of a dog's breakfast that we're doing all these different sections at this stage when in fact there's an opportunity next year to do this.
Well, I recall some of the discussion from the earlier panel session that you had this morning on this, and I think what I noticed was that some of the discussion on you know, whether the permanence of these provisions should be considered in the Year 2 Bill almost considered the current course of action in isolation rather than comparing it to that alternative course of action. If we were to consider this for the Year 2 Housing Bill, then effectively you have a situation where these provisions apply in the social rented sector but don't apply in the private rented sector. Then you bring them in, then you let them lapse, then you bring them in again. And I do think that would lead to significant confusion, almost bewilderment, to be honest, both for tenants and for landlords, and a significant risk of confusion at the tribunal level about precisely what they're supposed to do to treat each individual case at different times. I think the evidence and experience that we've had from the operation of these two specific temporary provisions is that they are both proportionate means of achieving a legitimate objective of the government, and that they've demonstrated a wider long-term value that transcends the particular circumstances of the pandemic. And so, yeah, having that sort of in-out approach of letting them lapse and then bringing them back in again, I think would cause far more confusion than you know any additional clarity that would come from consultation. And I would reinforce the fact that the strong support from particularly those organisations that are concerned with the rights and interests of tenants, but also the prevention of homelessness, I think gives us confidence that these measures will have a positive effect.
Thank you for that. And I was going to move on to that point because I think Mark Griffin raised some important points with regards to preventing homelessness. Now, that doesn't seem to have become a key part of this. For example, with regards to responsibility for homelessness services, my own council here in Edinburgh is currently missing out on about £9.3 million of funding because it's administered by the council, not by an integrated joint board. Now, I've raised this about five times now with ministers and haven't got an answer of why that situation's been allowed to occur. The council, I believe, are still trying to get answers. So why is something like that, which is really important, not being part of these measures to try to make sure that we see across Scotland that sort of problem taken forward and fixed? I'm imagining I will try to bring that forward maybe in the housing bill, but you know, there's lots of things which has been highlighted to us. It's only this specific issue which ministers have taken forward in this bill, when in fact there's lots of other things we should have been looking at.
Well, there's a great deal else that we are actively looking at in the development of the housing bill that will come forward and the consultation on the New Deal for Tenants. I would welcome any constructive proposals for the ideas that we should be considering for inclusion in that bill. I'm not sure if Miles Briggs is referring to correspondence he's had with me. It doesn't immediately ring a bell. It may be that it's other ministers who've dealt with that, so I'm not going to try and answer on their behalf around correspondence that I haven't seen, but I'll certainly take on if Miles Briggs wants to write to me about it to continue to explore that and to discuss with other colleagues who may have already considered his correspondence. I think the fundamental point about this bill is that it does give us the opportunity to make permanent provisions that were introduced on a temporary basis during the pandemic. That's its fundamental opportunity. And these two provisions of the four that I mentioned earlier in discussion with Mark Griffin, these two have clearly demonstrated themselves to be positive in terms of the impact that they have on people's lives of resolving some of those disputes between landlords and tenants, but also proportionate measures that can help the government to achieve its policy objectives beyond the pandemic. So this bill is the opportunity to do that relatively modest step in making permanent successful temporary provisions. But the wider question about, you know, other considerations that we need to take, the government will of course be open to constructive suggestions from all sides on that as we develop the next piece of housing legislation itself.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that, and I'll take your offer up, Minister, to write to you about some of this as well. Just finally, and it goes back to Graham Day's point, I think there are significant concerns within the private rented sector that they don't feel that they've been able to maybe get the Minister's ear to really look towards how this is going to impact on them. So in terms of drawing up of guidance, what's your plans with regards to including the sector? Because I think it's important that you know, the devil will be in the detail and that guidance being developed beyond what is currently in place from the public health emergency legislation Parliament passed, but where that will be influenced. And I know you gave Mr Day a commitment to listen to the sector, but where that can, their suggestions will actually be taken on board for that guidance as well.
Well, we certainly will continue to listen to the sector and to recognise, as one of your witnesses in the last session said, I think the word he used was heterogeneity, the very different circumstances of landlords in the private rented sector. I've certainly met with Scottish Association of Landlords and other organisations that represent the sector on the landlord side, as well as those who represent the interests of tenants. And I think there's probably a need to recognise that there is a shared interest here in achieving the two goals that I set out earlier of closing the gap in outcomes between the social and private rented sectors and raising the standards across the board. And good quality, responsible, professional landlords will see that as being in their interest as well. They don't want low quality, what sometimes get called rogue landlords operating in the sector. The professional and high quality parts of the private rented sector will want to see and do want to see good standards across the board and an end to unscrupulous or unacceptable behaviour. We do need to recognise that on a wide range of other issues beyond the specific measures that we're talking about today, as you heard in the earlier session, there are concerns around, for example, energy efficiency and the move to net zero. All political parties support that move to net zero, and I think the private rented sector itself recognises that there is work to do, that on average it has a lower level of energy efficiency than the rest of the housing stock, and that impacts on the affordability of housing for tenants as well. We need to make sure that we're supporting the whole sector to move forward with that agenda as we do with the rest of society. But I think the government continues to commit to working with the sector, listening to the sector and understanding its concerns, both from the point of view of those diverse landlords out there and in particular those who want to work with us to raise standards and the perspective of tenants as well.
Thank you,
Miles. And I'd now like to bring in Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you, Convener. And just before I ask my question, I was reflecting on your own view about looking at across the world for kind of examples of how companies countries operate. And here's one that I don't think we should ever take. I grew up in Montreal. Montreal is a city of predominantly renters and predominantly in the private rented sector. And leases run to the 1st of July every single year. And every year on the 1st of July, about 70,000 households move. And it's called Montreal Moving Madness, and I don't think we should ever seek to emulate anything like that. But seriously, the question I've got reflects just what Miles Briggs was speaking about and also Mark Griffin was touching upon. And we know that the private rental sector is a huge help in helping us to address homelessness. Those who are at risk of homelessness or who are indeed homeless have used the private rental sector for many years to get secure tenancies, and indeed the 2016 changes really did strengthen that. But we also know that pre-pandemic we had a lot of evictions from the private rented sector. Do you think that these two proposals specifically are going to help us to reduce that going forward? And do you think that they capture the recommendations that we've seen from the reconvened Hire Side group, from the Housing Policy Circle within the Social Renewal Advisory Board, and indeed the Prevention Review Group, who are now consulting on those prevention duties, which incidentally, you know, I wish that they were looked at in 2001 when we were first looking at the Homelessness Etc Act. So just your thoughts around about that.
Okay, thank you. I take the cautionary lesson about Montreal. I'll make a note that we won't seek too many lessons from that circumstance. Having said that, you know, the longer term work beyond these particular measures will include looking, for example, at the issue of winter evictions. And again, across different European countries, there's a range of different approaches taken to that. And we're going to be consulting on what the options are to recognise the particular circumstances in winter with the increased financial cost that people face at that time of year. For some parts of the winter, the lack of access that people may have to services if they need them at short notice. The similar concerns might be expressed that if you have a protected period from winter evictions, what happens when that comes to an end, and do you get unintended consequences of that? So we want to understand everybody's perspective on a proposal like that and make sure that we design provisions that will be right for Scotland's circumstances. I think the picture that Eleanor Whittam paints about the role of the private rented sector in relation to homelessness, it's what we should be aspiring to, that the private rented sector is one that provides flexibility, that provides people who are facing the risk of homelessness with ways of resolving that and avoiding that risk, but also provides the opportunity for people to move out of homelessness and get a tenancy that's going to be right for them, that's going to support them, that's in the right place and at an affordable price. That's what we should be aiming for, and it can do that. There have been other times when the private rented sector has been, as I said earlier, the biggest source of people becoming newly homeless, and that's what we need to avoid. And I think, again, the requirement for pre-action protocols, in line with what has already been acknowledged as best practice, good practice by good landlords who do want to avoid evictions. And let's recognise, good professional landlords don't like the idea of instability in their tenancies. They want stable tenancies that work. Having that goal of avoiding eviction, of trying to sustain a tenancy where it's possible, of reaching a way of doing that through discussion with the tenant, through pointing them in the direction of money advice services, financial support, that is absolutely a very clear way of making sure that we avoid a situation where people could face being evicted into homelessness where it is avoidable. And having the tribunal discretion, including the ability to take into account the circumstances in which the landlord has attempted to go through those steps of the pre-action protocol. Yeah, I think these steps will not be a silver bullet. No one's suggesting this is the only thing that we need to be doing, but will clearly be positive and beneficial in trying to prevent homelessness, and I think very much in line with the work of the groups that are looking at these issues that Eleanor Whittam mentions.
Thank you very much, Minister. I have another two wee questions on the back of that. So we heard from Don Blackwood of the Scottish Association of Landlords that they did seek to do that really collaborative work with their tenants. And we do know that there's a varying picture across the country for maybe landlords who aren't involved in that association. So what more can the government do to make sure that those support services on the ground are adequately resourced, that there's clear guidance around about how landlords and also housing associations that maybe have support services in the wider area, or indeed local authorities, how can they all work together cross-sector to make sure that those pre-action protocols deliver the results that we need to prevent the homelessness upstream?
I mean, I think in some circumstances, the awareness-raising work is particularly important here. As we said earlier, the diversity of the private rented sector is very significant. There will be landlords and perhaps maybe a little bit more likely to be the kind of landlords who join an organisation like the Scottish Association of Landlords, who are aware of best practice and also who are aware of the range of places they can signpost a tenant to for additional support if they need it. There will also be landlords who might not necessarily have encountered that before. Maybe they never intended to become a professional landlord. Maybe they've never had a tenant before, and it's a new experience for them, and that or never had a tenant who's in difficulty before. And if that's a new experience for them, they need to know. They need to have access to the information about how they can support their tenant, as well as having the requirement and the expectation that they should try. I mentioned earlier some of the ways in which the Scottish Government funds and supports and works with organisations in the public and voluntary sector to provide the services. But we also need to make sure that landlords and tenants are aware of those sources of support and can engage with that these steps that we describe in the pre-action protocol and do so with confidence and, you know, knowing what's required of them and you know, where they can get additional help if they need it.
So perhaps that's something that then could be looked at as to, the landlord registration scheme. So maybe there's a role for local authorities and when landlords are having to, you know, mandatory register with the local authority, that is communicated effectively to them as part of their duties going forward. My final question is just around about perhaps an unintended consequence that could come on the back of this, and it follows on from Graham Day's comments. We did hear from John Blackwood that there are going to be circumstances that landlords might find themselves in, and if mandatory grounds are removed, if the prevention of the homelessness for that landlord is an issue, so if they need the property back because of their financial circumstances, they have to sell or move into it, how much is the tribunal going to pay cognizance to that fact? Thank you.
Yes, I mean, I think this is where the phrase I started with, I think, in my opening remarks about striking the balance between the interests and rights of landlords and tenants comes in. The tribunal will take into account the circumstances as they pertain to landlords and to tenants. I think, you know, having some grounds where a tribunal is required, mandated to produce an eviction order, shifts things heavily in one direction. It overbalances things in terms of not taking account of the tenant's circumstances. But giving that tribunal discretion doesn't do the opposite. It doesn't take things to the other extreme. It sets things in balance and makes sure that the circumstances applying to both are taken into account fairly.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Eleanor. So that comes to the end of our questions. I'd like to thank the Minister and his officials for their evidence today, and concludes our evidence on the bill, and the committee will be invited to consider a draft report in the coming weeks. And I now suspend briefly to allow our witnesses to leave the room.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.